Absolutely. This man is a successful businessman who lives in the West Country. Once he was the king of all media. Today he means many things to many people. Not all of it good.
Personally speaking, Noel Edmonds has always been that annoying little twat in the pullovers with a beard. But professionally speaking, you know, he's one of the biggest names in TV over the last 20 years. And also, more importantly, one of the biggest influences on TV in the last 20 years.
Noel Edmonds was amazing in a way, in that he kind of straddled television for so many years.
That is, until the day Noel was thrown from the saddle of light entertainment in a fall that would reverberate through TV history.
I'm not just chasing fame per se. People like to see famous people. And it annoys me when people have a go at celebrities, you know, like poor Noel Edmonds. People going, oh, what's he doing going around hospital wards at Christmas, giving out presents to children? You know, oh, he's doing it for himself. And he's not doing it for himself. He's doing it for them. He's not doing it at all anymore. He can't go on telly for love nor money. But when he was doing it, he was doing it for them.
That's me beard. It's still there.
Yes, once upon a time, Noel Edmonds lit up the sky of TV light entertainment like a bearded bat signal. One that promised massive ratings.
I think if you said to people now, did you watch Noel's house party? They would recoil in horror and say, oh God, I never watched it. But you know, 12, 13, 14 million people watched that show every Saturday night. People tend to forget that now, and he has just become Noel Edmonds, the man the public loves to hate.
Look at that, what's that you've got there?
Noel, it's an old picture of you and you look slightly different.
No! Give us an air! I look slightly different! This is terrible!
Once, untold millions did like Noel Edmonds, yet now it seems many don't. British TV's most successful light entertainer hasn't filled our screens for 5 long years. Tonight, we ask, why?
On the one hand, you could say he's had a charmed life up to now. On the other hand, you could say he's cursed.
For me, and possibly you, it really is the end of an era. I hope your memory will be very kind to us after 169. Bye.
This, the final episode of House Party with its trademark but now elegiac slapstick gunging, was the last time millions of Britons saw Noel Edmonds in a starring role on their TV.
And even to the end, he was smiling and laughing with Freddie Starr. You didn't have any sympathy for him. You just wanted to get rid of him by the end.
How did it come to this? To try and find out, tonight we analyse the career path of an entertainment supernova, now rarely observed on our TV telescopes, and meet those who tried to cling to the flaming tail feather of his blazing talent.
Instead of being a successful venture, it turned out to be the biggest curse of my life.
Nothing could seem to sort of halt his march towards what was the ultimate dream for him, was this domination of Saturday Night Light entertainment.
The stunts they had on the Late Late Breakfast Show are so unbelievable, they were like a snuff movie waiting to happen.
Mr. Blobby was the worst role model you could have for children.
This is not entertainment anymore. This is something different.
By charting the ups and downs of a brilliant broadcasting career that suddenly stopped, perhaps we can find out why. It stopped. Noel declined the offer of an interview, so all we could do was quote him. Mike Reed, polymath DJ and former colleague of Noel, agreed to dress up as Noel and helped to clarify matters by reading out some choice Noel quotes.
Good evening, everyone. Tonight, I'm going to be Noel Edmonds.
Noel Ernest Edmonds' story begins with his birth in 1948 in Ilford, Essex. His childhood was so remorselessly boring, we're going to spare you the details. But even then, Noel was ambitious.
The fact that my school days were totally undistinguished bothered me. I was obsessed by what I thought was my obvious lack of star quality. It seemed that I didn't shine at anything as a teenager until I became totally involved with the idea of becoming a disc jockey.
From a makeshift studio in his bedroom, Noel recorded tapes, which he sent to radio stations up and down the country. Finally, Noel's knob twiddling pulled it off, landing him a job at Fab 208 Radio Luxembourg. Noel was working for the hippest pirate on the airwaves, although his first transmissions showed a spooky resemblance to Alan Wicker.
Multitudinous greetings to your sons and daughters. My name is Noel Edmonds, which probably means nothing to you. It means everything to me, and I hope it means something to one or two other people.
But Noel's first broadcasts, the realisation of so many years of tortured ambition and raw talent waiting to burst out, were nearly his only broadcasts.
The car that he had at the time, I remember, was one of those cars you make yourself, a kit car.
Ugly little thing, really. The car, I mean.
Oh.
Oh, no. It's a Marcus, a mini Marcus.
We got a telephone call to say that Noel had been in a car accident. So there was Paul Bennett and Tony Prince and I who ran off to the scene of this accident at an intersection.
A lorry just sliced through it, and it was a fiberglass thing, and it just broke into shards of plastic all over the place, and it was in two halves. And how he escaped that, I mean, talk about a charmed life. He should not have walked away from that. He walked away, not a scratch.
Yes, Noel walked unscathed from the wreckage, free to develop the zany sense of humour which would delight the nation for decades, until it didn't anymore. An eerie gotcha forebear saw David Kid Jensen subject to the kind of crazy jape that would characterise Noel's career.
And the idea of the gag was that Kid was to walk into his flat and discover that Noel had murdered Christine Prince and shoved her body under the bed for some reason, and then stuck his head in a fit of remorse, stuck his head in a gas oven in the kitchen, and like that, load of laughs.
I open the door and I see a pair of legs, girls' legs, with what looks like blood all over them. Turned out to be ketchup.
Didn't go into the kitchen to check on, you know, what had happened in there. Just ran screaming out of his flat.
So I was going to call the police to come and help me sort this out, because I just couldn't take it all in.
Ran, took off after him. I remembered, hang on, no, stuck on his head in the gas oven. Fast asleep now. So I rushed back in, dragged Noel out of the oven, turned the gas taps on, opened the windows and everything off, and Noel's, how did it go? Well, how did it go?
Noel's fake murder gag was to reverberate through time. In 1997, Noel himself fell victim to an almost identically dark joke.
The broadcaster and entertainer Clive Anderson has been shot dead by television host Noel Edmonds at his house in Cornwall this evening.
3 decades on, Chris Morris's spoof news report described a spookily similar macabre theme.
It was a glorious moment when Chris Morris got Noel Edmonds with the Clive Anderson, you know, shooting incident, decapitation, which you kind of, when you first heard it, believed it could be true.
Edmonds appeared at a top window with blood on his face and threw what may have been a head onto the ground below.
Back in 60s mainland Europe, the groundbreaking sense of fun that would ultimately be satirised landed Noel in some contentious hot water.
He wanted to play a joke on the station manager at Radio Luxembourg at the time, and they didn't always see eye to eye, so Noel went to fishmongers and bought a couple of small fish. And when we got to the offices, it was after hours, he then taped the fish to the underside of this fellow's desk.
And it just festered, this thing, and the stench was... I can now smell it. It was horrible.
I think they called in some experts to say, where is the smell coming from?
So it was stuff like that that, you know, brought it to a head, and he was asked if he wouldn't mind leaving at the first available plane. Bless him.
Or was he? Noel has always maintained that he resigned from Radio Luxembourg. In 1969, a 21-year-old broadcasting genius returned to his parents' house in Essex and would soon find stardom, cardom, and total domination of all media. Today, a glittering TV career has spent 5 years away from our TV screens. Why is Noel Edmonds cursed by our seeming indifference? Tonight, by charting that glittering TV career, we look for clues as to how that glittering career came not to glitter anymore. In 1969, Noel had just parted company with Radio Luxembourg. But Edmonds' career didn't end on the Benelux borders. Instead, it grew and grew.
It'll be mostly cloudy with outbreaks of rain or snow spreading from the west a little bit later. The snow, chiefly on hills, will be rather substantial, actually.
1969 saw the dawn of Noel Edmonds' 30-year dominance of British entertainment, with a superhuman energy and fiery creativity that is somehow no longer fashionable. After leaving Fab 208 in 1969, Noel went to live with his parents in the home county's Haven of Havering in Essex. After a few months, he got a job at the BBC, presenting programme trailers.
When he was at Luxembourg, he was a personality. When he was invited onto the BBC, that elevated him into superstar status in Havering.
It was always his intention to go to Radio 1. He genuinely enjoyed the ethos of the studio. He enjoyed putting shows together. He enjoyed just being involved in entertainment.
Love it, love it, love it.
Noel took his first great leap into broadcasting the day after another great leap happened 250,000 miles away. So the only absolutely guaranteed audience was Noel's mum.
Noel's mum's fantastic, and my memory is not so much a shrine, but it was as if there were nearly pictures on the ceiling, because you think, my goodness, you know, sort of this is someone who loves her son, and there were pictures of him everywhere, doing all sorts of things.
Noel swiftly got a regular slot on Saturday afternoons, and another change. The trademark tidy beard arrived.
Have you really shaved it off? No, Pauline. Have a listen. That's my beard, it's still there.
I think he feels very secure behind the beard. It's okay, he wouldn't be Noel without the beard, would he? He just wouldn't.
Noel's trimmed beard and increasing popularity was getting him noticed.
He clearly impressed the listeners and the powers that be there, and he ended up getting the breakfast show, which was like being given the keys to heaven in terms of DJ-dom.
But other jocks had been sent to hell before Noel ascended to Radio Heaven. First to go was Kenny Everett, sacked for misbehaving. Noel took over his midday programme.
I received letters of frightening abuse from Everett fans who had convinced themselves that I was personally responsible for getting rid of him.
Second DJ to be smote down was Tony Blackburn. He was ankled from the coveted morning slot, and Noel stepped in.
Well, before Noel came along, you either had Kenny Everett, who was this maverick, kind of wild, kind of naughty sort of bloke, or you had Tony Blackburn, who was Mr. Cheese. And Noel just came in and kind of occupied the middle ground and was a bit dangerous, but not too dangerous, and was a bit smarmy, but not that smarmy. So he was perfect.
He did the breakfast show at Radio 1 for 5 years, 73 to 78. And I have to say, if there'd been Sony Awards in those days, he probably would have won one every year. It was a great show.
Noel's transition from junior jock to deity DJ was complete. But nothing supernatural, like witches and stuff, were ever involved. That would be stupid.
I don't think there's any weird mojo involved with Noel. I think it is just his single-mindedness, that, you know, if he has an objective, he will see it through. He has this uncanny ability to see opportunities and make them work for himself.
As his audience and popularity grew unchecked, Noel revelled in the trappings of 70s DJ superstardom.
One thing we must ask, please, please don't push.
Soon he was raking it in with personal appearances at supermarkets, discotheques and boutiques.
He certainly was one of the first people in show business to really put himself out as a brand, you know, to market his whole persona and his image.
I am a mercenary individual. Money is important to me. I have never hesitated to cash in on my success.
In those golden mid-70s, Noel had it all. A fine pair of wide flares, a monkey bike, a lovely wife, a novelty kitchen, and cars. Lashings of cars.
One of the things I love, and I still love, about Noel Edmonds is the fact that he is an out-and-out boy racer. He loves his toys.
And Noel got involved with lots of other boys, as racing teams clamoured for Noel to play with them.
In motorsport in general, you want publicity. You know, to get sponsorship, you want publicity, and I think Noel was obviously beautifully placed. He was an absolute darling for any racing team.
Noel's love of speed, of pushing things to the limit, perhaps defined his career. And in 1973, it helped him find a new sidekick.
And I just walked up to him and said, look, I obviously know who you are, you don't know who I am. I'd like to have a chat to you about racing because I know you're interested in doing some proper racing other than this celebrity stuff. And we got talking. What happened ultimately was that I got to go to his radio studio. Noel got to race my car and he lost control at Clearways Bend and just totaled my pride and joy, Escort Mexico.
Just like his earlier prang in Luxembourg, Noel emerged unscathed and helped Mike Smith get a job at the BBC. But Noel's love of speed meant more prangs. In 1974, he took part in the Tour of Britain rally with his wife Jill as co-driver, navigator, person.
They had this gate, you see, that was going like that. And I thought the car was going straight.
I missed a corner, completely got it wrong, and left the road doing about 60 miles an hour. And we did two end-over-ends, and we did two sideways rolls, and finished up parks on top of another car, which had also done a similar manoeuvre. Belonged to a vicar, actually. And the Reverend Rupert, I'd like to say a very good morning to, and thank you for your words of comfort.
Divine intervention, we'll never know. But once again, Noel was preserved to innovate.
Stand by, Noel.
This time for kids, on Saturday, in the mornings.
I really remember waking up at the weekend, you know, there was no school, and I had the whole morning to watch Swap Shop. It was brilliant.
I did have a crush on him, I have to admit it, when I was younger. I just thought he was fantastic.
Swap Shop was the first programme where the presenter openly acknowledged things like cameramen and made you realise, no, this isn't a little magical world, this is the real world, and this is how we make it. And as a result, it was great. You really, you felt Noel Edmonds was your pal.
I was one of those people that was always, always, without fail, on the end of the phone every single week, trying to desperately swap something just to speak to Noel.
In a way, with Swap Shop, all kids loved it because they were involved in it. It was kind of interactive. To me, it was the first kind of interactive telly.
Well, the one flaw of the swapping part of Swap Shop was kids were just phoning up with things they didn't want, so it'd be really rubbish stuff. So they're trying to swap ridiculous things like, I don't know, a broken action man, and they'd want a motorised car, please.
And what would you hope to get?
29 function digital watch.
You're feeling you've got your own telly, teenage telly. Your parents thought it was mad and it didn't make any sense, and even to them, Noel Edmonds would have looked like Jimi Hendrix.
Swap Shop was also responsible for launching the careers of a TV power trio, Craven, Philbin and Chegwin.
Cheggers was always the sort of cheeky, chappy little joker chap, and he was always out in the cold.
Noel would say, where are you? And he'd quite often not be ready.
Keith, where are you?
I think we've caught him out, whatever he's doing.
Love it.
Swap Shop was immensely successful for him. It brought him to the notice of a much wider audience than Radio 1. And I think in Noel's mind, TV was more important because it had immense power. And he seemed to really enjoy that. Engine
efficiency. And Noel also enjoyed hosting other shows.
Now, many of us probably don't know how it functions properly. A standard ignition produces a spark like that.
Yet Noel's love of multimedia risk-taking cost him dear when he met this man, Basil Wainwright. Basil offered to help Noel realise a dream, breaking the world water speed record in a groovy futuristic boat called Excalibur.
I remember seeing these pictures of this sort of boat plane and just thinking, wow, that looks super cool.
There was some merit to the design, and I think it was a feasible design and it could have worked.
Noel thought so too. He put in 70 grand.
Difficult to overstate what a vast amount of money that was a quarter of a century ago. Depends what you're buying, but a good guesstimate of what that would be worth now is £250,000.
What was under question was where the money was going that Noel was giving Mr. Wainwright, and of course the project ground to a halt when Noel realised that the money wasn't going where it should have been going.
Oh, I'd been a right pillock, and I don't mind admitting it. What a wally I'd been to fall for someone like that.
I hear that he still keeps a model of Excalibur, Project Hiderwing, in his house, probably to remind him of perhaps the error of his ways at that time.
But you did, for example, have a go at the world water speed record.
Yeah.
And that sadly all fell apart, didn't it?
Yes, that's a dream shattered, which I can't mention because the gentleman I was involved with is the subject of some legal charges.
Might you ever try that again?
I'd love to. It wasn't a gimmick. I didn't do it as a joke. I lost a lot of money, so I certainly didn't do it as a joke.
Dented finances didn't stop Noel's pursuit of cutting-edge TV entertainment. When Swap Shop ended in 1982, Noel made the shift to the big Saturday night gig, the Late Late Breakfast Show. Even the titles looked big.
It was like an advert, like a commercial for Noel Edmonds. Noel Edmonds was the product. And so it had that kind of, you know, almost milk tray, sort of seductive, you know, sense that Noel Edmonds was actually quite a sexy man, really.
But Noel's relentlessly upward curve was about to droop.
Well, sadly for Noel, Late Late Breakfast Show didn't take off initially because it was a big, clunking mess.
First year was a complete disaster. First year nearly got taken off the air. First year nearly killed someone.
With hindsight, those stunts on the Late Late Breakfast Show were a disaster waiting to happen because they got more and more reckless, more and more frantic, more and more boy racer.
I was amazed by that first crash on the Late Late Breakfast Show because you could see that the bloke wasn't going to make it. He crashed well before the end. And yet they kept the cameras rolling. And you were thinking, hang on a minute, that bloke might be dead.
Well, back in the studio, Noel remained unfazed.
It certainly looked remarkably frightening. From the pictures I can see, they're sorting him out. We'll keep you posted as to what happens.
With Noel's help, the unfortunate victim of the stunt gone wrong made a full recovery. And in the kind of bounce back he would consistently make, until recently, Noel bounced back. After the first series limped to a close, the show was revamped and a fresh face was brought in.
It was a stroke of genius when they brought Mike Smith on for the second series of the Late Late Breakfast Show because in many ways he was like a mini-me version of Noel Edmonds.
I can't analyse it. It was just a magic that happened.
Snowy, would you stop that? What are you doing?
I think she's after your nuts.
I think it probably is.
It was a feeling of almost like a double act. You know, before we knew where we were getting 22.5 million viewers on a Saturday night, and we'd knocked EastEnders off the top of the ratings, and Michael Grade had called us, bizarrely, this man is now chairman of the BBC, he called us the best double act since Morecambe and Wise.
With Mike's on-location help, Noel was the king of Saturday night. But then an on-location tragedy nearly ended his career, as contestant Michael Lush fell to his death. The BBC was slammed for safety shortcuts, and although Noel had nothing to do with the disaster, it would haunt him for the rest of time.
When they approached me about it, they said, we'd like you to come along and supervise it. And I therefore said to them, what you need here is an airbag beneath him as a safety measure. They said, how much was an airbag going to cost? And I couldn't tell the exact fee. But the airbag that I had in mind, which would safely cover somebody up to the kind of heights that they were talking about, was, for argument's sake, £250 a day. And they said, oh, no, we can't possibly afford that. And my response to that was, well, then you can't afford me, because that's what I see as the safety requirement.
While the box itself was made to high safety standards, there was no backup of any kind. And Michael Lush should have been attached to a safety line. Perhaps most importantly, there should have been an inflatable airbag underneath him.
The BBC cancelled the series immediately, breaking precedent with an unusually frank live statement.
Because of the tragic accident involving Michael Lush while preparing for tonight's edition of the Late Late Breakfast Show, the BBC has decided to cancel this and all future editions of the programme.
I arrived home and there was a hand-delivered statement through the door and a letter from the head of Light Entertainment, which basically said, look, they're going to cancel the show. Decision was taken this morning, Saturday morning. And it also said in the letter, it has been agreed that nothing will be said to the press and that Noel, for his part, you know, wants to remain quiet. That was on the Saturday. On the Sunday, Noel was pictured leaning over his garden fence in Buckinghamshire, blubbing his heart out to the press, saying, my career is over. I don't think I can go back to television.
It obviously was a seismic event in not only in Noel's career, but in terms of the BBC hierarchy. And quite rightly, heads rolled. Noel didn't come back on television for a while. And when he did come back, things were very different.
Tonight, we chart one of the most dramatic careers in British TV history. In 1986, the tragic death of a member of the public whilst preparing for a stunt led to the cancellation of Noel Edmonds' Late Late Breakfast Show.
After the death of Michael Lush, I think a lot of people probably wrote off Noel Edmonds, but I always thought that he'd return to our screens because television was where he belonged, really.
After a four-month hiatus, Noel did return to TV with the Saturday Roadshow. And of course, Noel was still dishing out the midweek methadone to a nation of telly addicts, successfully institutional since 1985.
It was the forerunner of all the television quiz shows that feed on each other, that feed on themselves.
Next question is for Fattest Son Only. Name any one book. Anything at all? Anything? Anything you've ever read? Anything?
TV Times?
Yeah. No. I'm afraid I can't say that because it's got Katie Boyle in it. Now,
Noel was back. Although another terrible accident, this time involving his erstwhile sidekick, was another setback he would have to recover from.
The couple were flying in to a party at some friend's house in the Gloucestershire hills when two-seater Robin's helicopter apparently developed a serious engine fault during its final approach. It crashed through some trees and turned over, leaving Sarah with broken legs and a broken arm, and Mike with concussion.
Now, I remember when I just had my helicopter accident and lying in Cheltenham Hospital and not really wanting to hear the word helicopter or even see a helicopter for quite a while. And there was a phone call from Noel, he got through to the hospital, he said, I want to come and see you and Sarah. Where can I land the helicopter?
Mike made a full recovery, and so did Noel. In 1991, Noel's love of full-throttle risk-taking and the attendant high-octane, practical joke-filled light entertainment which had defined his career produced his biggest hit yet. Yet the ultimate Edmonds format would eventually see his popularity vanish. And being liked, as we've seen, was one of Noel's ultimate self-confessed driving forces.
This was Noel's house and he was letting you into his house. He was trying to do a huge, you know, hey, we're all mates, we all pop round to each other's house, but what our own little, can a TV community please like me?
House Party arrived without much pre-publicity and without much fuss. And within a very short period of time, it had completely taken over Saturday nights.
Opening with a big chopper shot revealing the iconic country house used in Shakespeare in Love, combined with modish music, pounding beats and lots of clapping, House Party was destined for success.
From the very start of House Party, it was all about him, you know, a big country pad, audience clapping him, he's up on the balcony like some majestic squire or something like that, almost like royalty. And it was all about Noel Edmonds, I'm back and I'm bigger.
He did have some fairly big-name guests, and politicians will do anything to get on television. So, and Edwina Curry particularly will do anything to get on television. Edwina came on, sat in the chair, and was given what you might call a major gunging, again.
They had gunge, you know, they put people in stocks, they played pranks. It was, you know, it's Tiz Was on BBC One on Saturday night. Noel's House Party was basically a kids' TV show. But now,
and the concept and environment that House Party was set in was just a kid's rude joke.
I hated the name Crinkly Bottom. I bet you sleepless nights. Oh, Crinkly Bottom, oh God. Is it too disgusting? Is it too filthy? Is it too rude? You know what I mean? Oh no, am I gonna, you know, and eventually, I bet someone had to persuade him. I bet you'd have a big committee said, no, it's okay, no, Crinkly Bottom's not rude, you know what I mean? You're not calling it Big Cock House, you know, Crinkly Bottom. You're not even saying arse.
As well as coy, anus-related single entendres, gooey slapstick and celebs, Noel also moved the TV goalposts into the slips, voyeuristically violating our homes with NTV.
Basically, Noel would send a camera crew around to some bloke's house or some woman's house, he'd have a live link and all of a sudden he'd say, I'm talking to you, Brian, whatever your name is, and you get some idiot sitting in a chair going, oh, I'm on telly.
I'm sitting there reading the Daily Mail and all of a sudden the TV started talking to me.
Hi, Gary Bushell!
And I'm on television, drunk, reading the paper. I've so, never sold that so fast in my life.
Hi, I see you were concentrating on my show, Mr. Bushell.
To make the situation even more bizarre and surreal, all of a sudden the roly-polies came storming in and they're breaking me set with their big fat arses. It was just a really strange day.
Noel's prying antics extended to House Party's most popular strand, the Gotcha Oscars.
It took celebrity for the first time, used it, recognised its appeal, and then abused it.
It was a big hand with this tiny little person trying to escape. It's a little bit sinister, isn't it, really, if you think about it? It's like, we've got you.
When I start thinking about the gotcha, my blood boils, basically.
Say hello to Sharon Dyke.
Noel pretended to be part of a fictitious and very bad pub quiz team.
Crawley.
Hello, Dave!
There she is.
I'm in there doing my thing and I'm thinking I've got the worst two teams in the world and I'm getting more and more frustrated with everything.
What?
And Noel walks in with a mobile phone and I can't begin to explain the feeling when I saw his face appear because it's just a split second of denial.
I do not. If this is for real, if this is for real, this man dies of it.
I was shaking. There was steam coming out of my ears.
You are a dead man!
And then, as soon as the mic closed, I let rip with every word in the book. And I'd forgotten, of course, that the cameras were still rolling. And that tape exists. And I should think he's worth a lot of money now.
No, it's not. I got it for nothing off the internet.
Fuck you! You You fucking bastard!
Noel's house party was getting anything up to 11, 12, 13 million viewers every Saturday night, which is incredible looking back on those kind of figures now.
After three solidly successful years, Noel talked to ITV. The BBC panicked and Noel got a new contract.
I was absolutely astounded when Alan Yentob, who was then controller of BBC One, I think, described it as the most important programme on the BBC. And I think Noel's head swelled to enormous proportions at that point.
When Oppenheimer watched the first atomic tests in New Mexico, he whispered, "Now I am become Shiva, destroyer of worlds." And in 1992 in Crinkly Bottom, Noel split the entertainment atom, creating a big, fat, pink apocalypse.
Mr. Blobby. Christ. Mr. Blobby.
The very idea that Mr. Blobby should be the sort of the highlight of Saturday evening's viewing, a sort of, you know, pathetic, slapstick, violent creature that, you know, that was disaster, really, in terms of dumbing down.
Mr. Blobby became the icon that more than Noel and was more likely to get an OBE. He couldn't really speak, he couldn't say anything, he had no real wit. He just wanted to roll on top of people and make them look stupid. We kind of put up with it and people fell for it and they bought the bloody things and bought the records. You know, somebody, there were people who did that.
In their millions, the single Mr. Blobby was a Christmas number one and children everywhere were singing.
I think it will go down in history as one of the pure low points in broadcasting in the United Kingdom and as a terrible indictment of where the British mentality was at the time that thought it was so funny.
Blobby went on to spawn best-selling videos, board games, toys and playground terror for fat kids all over the country.
He gave us Mr. Blobby and that will be his legacy and his gravestone will be in that shape. And it's given him so much wealth because somehow he managed to own the rights to this stupid creature.
He's a good businessman who has seen that entertainment was one of the big ways to make money.
I mean, I get quite upset when people write articles sort of saying businessman Noel Edmonds and whatever.
Really? You don't? Because you've made an attempt to be involved in lots of different businesses.
Yeah, but I think businessman, I mean, I think it's just such a ghastly term. What I am is business-like.
He's concerned about money, you see. He's got to make more money.
But I think it's more to
when's
do.
When's enough? Enough, though. That's
I don't
the big
think
problem.
It's about money with Noel. I think
no?
It is about being respected.
Back in 1985, Noel had founded his own company, the Unique Group. A decade on, Unique set out to create a chain of theme parks. The first opened in 1994 on Noel's West Country doorstep, run by a pair of local businessmen, the Taylor brothers, in a village called Cricket St. Thomas.
Well, it's the hustler in him, isn't it? And thinking that maybe he could become a kind of British Walt Disney. He just thought it's the obvious thing. Theme parks, you know. Edmonds Land is probably what he really wanted, you know. Noel World.
And I actually think that Crinkly Bottom at Cricket St Thomas will outlive House Party. It will probably outlive Noel Edmonds.
Although the first year was successful, the crowds began to seep out of Noel's Crinkly Bottom until attendance dwindled to just one peacock. Ensuing disputes between Unique and the Taylors eventually saw bankruptcy proceedings issued against the brothers. Noel called a press conference.
We are owed a significant sum of money and the Taylors can't pay us, which leads one to worry, will the animals get fed this winter? Will there be jobs there this winter?
Where next for the Disney of Devon?
This is the backdrop, which is second to none in the UK. And this is Happy Mount Park, where it all happened with Noel Edmonds' World of Crinkly Bottom.
Or more where it didn't happen.
Another home was found for the theme-themed antics in Morecambe, which was not wise. In 1994, Unique got into bed with Lancaster City Council, and a few months later, Crinkly Bottom North was born, in Morecambe.
That was the main entrance. They walked through there, and they came out the other end, and they went in the little train. That was free. They could ride on the train, and that ended up clapped out, I believe, because it was the only thing that was worth going on.
I think the people of Morecambe thought that there would be something more there, more rides, more entertainment, etc., etc. I feel that the local council perhaps got a bit starry-eyed and carried away with what they thought they could achieve.
The park closed after 13 weeks. The council sued Unique for breach of contract. Unique countersued.
Well, there's quite a few councillors jumping up and down now and quite a few local people in Morecambe saying the venture could never have worked.
The actual park did work. By LCC's figures, it's not a Unique group boast. We know that over 120,000 people went to it during its short life, but it was very, very badly set up and managed. We've got nothing to do with that.
Sure enough, Noel won almost £1 million in damages from the council.
Instead of being a successful venture, it turned out to be the biggest curse of my life.
The next bit of themery was to turn Bicton Park in Devon into gotcha land.
The word gotcha land means that when you get there, you're gotcha'd. Everything was a trick. There was speedboat rides and there wasn't any speedboats. There were performing dolphins and there were no dolphins, but people queued up to get in. And of course, the trick was to see how long they waited until they got fed up.
Strangely, the joke fell flat. Gotcha land flopped and an already struggling Mr. Stevens went out of business. But the gotcha concept was about to turn on Noel himself, as fashions changed and the joker became the joke.
The wonderful thing about what Chris Moyes did with cake was that he truly, you know, he did give Noel Edmonds a resounding gotcha.
It was a made-up drug called cake, which should have given you a bit of a warning when you saw it. It was the size of a discus, and various celebrities were invited to pontificate about the dangers of cake.
Can we lose this thing about the slow crushing of his skull?
No one understood how to get the message over better than this man.
How can anybody sit there and talk about a large tablet about cake and keep a straight face?
What is cake? Well, it has an active ingredient, which is a dangerous psychoactive compound known as dimesmeric Anderson phosphate. It stimulates the part of the brain called Shatner's bassoon.
What Chris Morris was doing, you know, really, was pointing out that whatever Noel Edmonds says, he's not listening to himself. And if he's told it's for charity, then he'll adopt a position and he'll do that and he'll be sincere, you know, like Huey Green he'll be, you know, because he can do that.
Thank you for listening to me. Take care. And I really do mean take care.
Only Noel went nuclear when he discovered he'd been hoaxed, and he accused Chris Morris of being irresponsible and saying drugs is not a laughing matter, thereby missing the whole point of the fact that celebrities will say anything about a fashionable cause like drugs. And I just thought, Noel, say nothing. Don't do this, because you're making yourself look even more stupid and petty and small-minded. But no, he just couldn't hold himself back.
Noel couldn't gag Brass Eye, and the DVD is still on sale. But back in Noel's crinkly bottom, something soft and pink was blobbing all over our screens as a light entertainment curse finally began to take hold.
He said, I can't act, I can't sing, I can't dance, I'm not very funny. And I said, but it's too late, Noel, you're a star.
The 90s. Having conquered radio, TV and commerce, Noel Edmonds was a pulsing supernova, composed of entertainment, innovation and money, with Noel's house party throbbing at its core, fueled by Edmonds' most controversial creation, Bloppy.
People see me and say, oh, there goes Mr. Blobby's dad. Funnily enough, he was never meant to be one of the more enduring characters on television.
But he was, and Blobby seemed to breed, spreading cursed havoc around the country, as this ill-fated ice hockey star found out to his cost.
As I was passing out through the reception, I was just asked if I would take part in a photo shoot for publicity reasons. He put his arm around me, grabbed me at the top of my head and my forehead, and then all of a sudden, Blobby seemed to kneel down and genuflect in front of me, and when I looked down, up came his elbow straight into my face, into my nose, lifted me off my feet. I hit the trophy cabinet, and really that's all I remember about the situation until I was carted off for medical attention.
Paul suffered a broken nose, concussion and bruising over his entire face, and cruel ice hockey crowds just found it funny.
And every ice stadium that we went to at the beginning of the game, we always ended up coming out to the theme tune of Mr. Blobby.
With various Blobbies appearing at sporting events across the country, there was a further incident.
Mr. Blobby was brought along to provide the entertainment before yesterday's central match live between Peterborough United and Leicester City. But referee Brian Coddington from Sheffield didn't enjoy the fun when the 7-foot Mr. Blobby pushed him to the ground. Mr. Coddington said he could have been injured and was going to take up the incident with the Football League.
And it didn't stop there. At times, and especially on the set of House Party, it looked as though Mr. Blobby was taking over from mine host, Noel Edmonds.
Blobby turned into a monster. And the thing is, I think by the end, there was a real resentment between Noel and Blobby because Blobby became bigger than Noel.
Darkly echoing the killing of Bambi's mother, Noel executed the kid's favourite, Blobby, live when he was caught on the hop by a surprise phone call, asking if he would be bringing Blobby back.
And we've done a lot of research into the popularity of Blobby, and frankly, the public don't like him anymore. So...
What? Oh, that's an outrage!
That is just not on! Blobby.
He's gone. He's definitely gone. House Party's a Blobby-free zone. Frankly, and I think I can say this now, I loathe him.
During his 6-year reign, Blobby's antics seemed, to some observers, pinkly to embody some of Noel's very own character traits.
I found Blobby a bit like Noel, you know, someone who desperately wanted to be lovable, but wasn't.
Noel is an extraordinary mixture of bumptious and cocky and incredibly thin-skinned.
There's a certain something about his personality where he has this slightly petulant quality, where he doesn't quite see it. He can't quite see himself as others see him.
Whether Noel was petulant or not, he certainly incorporated similar qualities into his on-screen persona, cleverly blurring the lines between fantasy and reality as he impersonated a sulky little shit.
That really puts me in a bad mood when people do that silly, pathetic, juvenile joke.
We did have moments when we argued, particularly about comedy. And we were arguing about something, and Noel said, I think you'll find it's my show.
By the 7th series, the entertainment fizz of Noel's house party was going flat, and there weren't many ratings crisps left in the bowl either.
Because it was successful to start with, nobody then dared to say to him, it was going wrong now.
Television seemed to have moved on, but Noel hadn't. And the stunts were getting sort of more and more strained and desperate.
And he couldn't, for reasons he best knows, arrest the decline. That's when he started, you know, flouncing off.
He was absolutely distraught about the content of the entire show. And when we read through in the producer's office, just a few of us read through what the content, he hated it. and he put the script down and he said, well, I wish you good luck with it. I'm certainly not doing it.
I read with everybody else that it had all gone to hell.
Yeah, I had a row with the BBC.
And you were walking out and you were... So what, tell me really what happened.
It just reached the point where someone had to say enough, and it had to be me. And I remember it as one of the darkest moments of my career.
So dark that Noel kissed and made up with the Beeb and did another series.
It was just disastrous. It was absolutely awful because it had just lost its way.
The ratings for Noel's House Party by the end had sunk to something like 5.9 million, which was in many ways a shadow of what it had been in its heyday.
House Party started when ratings didn't really matter that much. And House Party ended when ratings did matter, and it ended because he lost two-thirds of his audience. It's as simple as that.
And that was that. Mainstream TV and Noel Edmonds had parted company.
Some people, when they lose all that, when it goes, they go over the edge, they drink, they whatever, their life starts to fall apart. Noel hasn't done that. He's got way too much self-control.
While Noel's light entertainment vision no longer dominates the viewing world, he is now free to be rich in Devon and run his lucrative group of companies. He's also become a country gentleman.
Very concerned about the government's attitude.
Noel is now the public face of horses and deputy lieutenant of Devon. He even shaved off his little beard to raise money for foot and mouth.
It's a picture of a baby's bottom.
And on top of all that, he's recently threatened the world with a blobby comeback.
It must be very difficult for Noel, who is not an old man, to switch on his television, and he must just wonder, why am I not on it when there's so much crap on it? I can produce better crap than that.
I bet you, if he was on now, he'd create something that lots of people would watch again.
He will always bounce back. He's golden balls. He will always come back.
And in a career defined by bouncing back, Noel himself delights in keeping us guessing. And perhaps the current curse of lost popularity is only temporary.
I must admit, I've been having one or two little...
Have you?
Funny feelings. Yes. Yeah, one or two urges recently.
Yes.
Yeah, because the nation cannot sleep at night for fear I could be back.
Well, coming up next on Five, we're going swinging. Well, not literally, you understand. It's comedy time in just a moment on Five.